certainly want to take a close look at the legal issues. So joining us here in Los Angeles, criminal defense attorneys Brian Claypool and Austin Dove. Good to see you both. Brian, first to you, some legal experts, they've really gone quick to, you know, calling this out as something which could amount to treason, this meeting between Donald Jr. and the Russian lawyer. Okay, the U.S. Constitution says treason against the United States shall consist only in levying war against them or in adhering to their enemies, giving them aid and comfort. I'm no lawyer, which is why you guys are here, but I read that. This doesn't sound like treason, Brian.
Well, this absolutely isn't treason because Donald Trump Jr. didn't receive any information that would aided and comforted the election process for his father, number one. Number two, there's a federal election law that you didn't mention, and I'm going to read this to you, and I'm going to tell you why, as it stands now, the facts do not support Donald Trump having committed an illegal act. The federal election laws say soliciting or accepting anything of value in connection with an election from a foreign national. So the key here is Donald Trump didn't solicit anything. He was approached, apparently a music publicist friend approached Donald Trump, said, hey, I want you to meet this female Russian lawyer. So he didn't solicit anything, number one. And number two, what did Donald Trump Jr. receive in this meeting of value that somehow help the election process? My argument would be, at this point, we don't have any evidence whatsoever to support that Donald Trump Jr. received anything of value in that meeting.
But there are some timing issues, right? That if you look at some of the timing of when Donald Trump tweeted about emails and when he started going after Hillary Clinton about her emails and asking Russia to bring, those things happened after this meeting, not long after this meeting. So there are some, as we talked about earlier, some dots there. They have not all been connected. And of course, we don't have all
the
evidence.
You got to connect those dots, though.
That's right.
Because perception versus legality are two vastly different concepts.
Okay, so what you get to what Brian's, because do you agree with his assessment here? Or do you think there was something of value? Because New York Times was reporting he was told ahead of time, hey, there's damaging information that we could have, the Russian government has, to help your dad get elected. Isn't that something of value?
Damaging information is itself the value here. Yeah. I mean, let's not be naive. We're looking at a significant election, a major pivotal point in the election against the basically the only, he had just been named the Republican candidate. Now he's going against the Democrat. The only remaining standards are those two. And it's information against that particular candidate. Not one of the many Republicans he ran against, but that particular candidate. That has immense value. That's tremendously important to the campaign. And indeed, it has remained the issue throughout and beyond the campaign. So I would say the inherent value is the information there. It doesn't have to be money or stocks or something that we think of in other ways of value. The value was itself the information.
Let me read to you what the legal scholar Lawrence Tribe tweeted after hearing all this. He said, attempted theft of a presidential election in collusion with Putin is a serious felony and a high crime against the state. Is there a law specifically talking about collusion? We know we've heard about treason, but collusion itself?
Well, that really falls under the umbrella of conspiracy. So okay. if there are, there's obviously numerous people on the staff, many people worked around this issue, and we just talked about the fact that this information came from one source and then leaked, you know, sort of filters its way to Donald Trump Jr. He arranges or accepts a meeting. So there's numerous people who are participating in that process. And if those individuals are in violation of the election laws, are in violation of federal statute that very specifically outline what you can do with a foreign national, the foreign countries that really cannot really be specifically kind of stepping on the toes of our election process, then you do get into process of collusion, and it raises some very, very disturbing and important questions in that area.
Brian, is smiling.
Yeah, is it codified?
look, I think this is a knee-jerk reaction. You've got to look at the entire context of this meeting. Remember, The female lawyer, I can't pronounce her name.
That's why I keep saying
forget.
Russian
I'll just say female, esteemed female lawyer from Russia.
Who we don't know if she's connected to the Kremlin directly.
Right. Number one, we don't. And I believe Donald Trump Jr.'s position, and I think it's well founded, is that she used having some information that might help his father in the election as a pretext to get the meeting. And then when they get in this meeting, 5 minutes into the discussion, she's talking about Russian adoption of children in the U.S. And then the meeting went south after that.
But to be fair, I do want to open this door, because does this, when you look at it on its face, does it show that Donald Trump Jr. was open to the idea of collusion? Because that is what it might appear to someone looking at this from the outside.
You get a gold star for that fact. But the problem with that is that doesn't end up in any legal culpability. I would argue the fact that there's no question. In fact, Donald Trump Jr. has come forward and said, hey, look, albeit late in the game, he said, look, I did have a meeting with her. We did talk about this. The fact that he knew ahead of time that she might have some information that might be detrimental to Hillary Clinton in the campaign, that in and of itself is not enough to hold him legally culpable.
Very quickly, I just want to read the statement we have from Donald Trump Jr.'s attorney, which came out after the New York Times story a few hours ago. Here's part of it. At no time was there ever any understanding or commitments that he or anyone else would find the information, whatever it turned out to be reliable, credible, all of interest, or would even survive due diligence. The meeting lasted about 20 to 30 minutes. Nothing came of it. His father knew nothing about it. The bottom line is that Don Jr. did nothing wrong. But Austin, that was so very carefully worded, and it sounded like to me that what they're keeping in mind there is this issue of value. You know, this information was of no value. There was nothing there. And I think lawyers are worried about the electoral laws when it comes to receiving something of value from a foreign national.
Exactly. The issue is this. He took that meeting with a particular intent. I don't believe there's any way you could say he took the meeting because she was going to talk about an adoption process for a president or a person who hadn't even been elected president yet, or there was some sort of public policy issue or some you know, benign reason that this meeting was put together. This meeting was put together very specifically about information that would damage the opponent, that would damage Hillary Clinton, benefit Donald Trump, and that's where that's the gravamen of this here. You can't escape that reality by saying, well, later on, nothing came out of the meeting. It was, it was less than productive. It turned out to be a dead end. That's still significant about what the intent was. And if you wrap this around all the other issues we have going on, to this date, as recently as this weekend, some sort of, soft peddling about what's going on and with Russia, and now we're going to do a joint operation on the cybersecurity issue. I mean, you still have a very cloudy issue from the Trump administration and preceding its administration and up to the current time about what's happening with Russia. And as long as it stays vague there's going to be these questions. Some of these can be put to rest. I agree with Brian, with a little bit more transparency, but you can't have it both ways.
All right, gentlemen.
Just 20 seconds.
Let's go to the horse's mouth. Why not talk to the female Russian lawyer?
We're trying.
Let's find out. Well, if they can get her under subpoena, I mean, you can probably get to the bottom of this very quickly. But I feel at the end of the day, a lot of smoke, but they're no illegal act.
Nice gray suits. Got the memo. Looking sharp. Appreciate it. Thank you both.
I want my blue tie.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Very good. Thanks, guys. Appreciate it.